So we crossed the border from Washington into BC. We crossed it at night, hoping that there would be less pain crossing over at night. And it turns out that the border guard didn't care about anything except for our COVID symptoms, which we had none, so we got to cross over very easily. Once we did, though, we didn't really know how we were going to quarantine for 14 days. So we ended up spending quite a bit of time in the Abbotsford Walmart parking lot because they still allowed for overnight parking and not a ton of camping places were still accepting reservations. We did manage to find one. So we headed there. I think we booked about 10 days maybe.
Yeah, 10 days.
We booked about 10 days there. And so we decided to quarantine in a camping spot in BC before making any other plans.
Yeah. And once we did that, I mean, they were even surprised that we got a reservation. They're like quite hostile when we arrived. Do you have a reservation? It's like, yeah, no, we made one. And they're surprised that we were one of the last ones to get one. So we were lucky in that way. But it was a pretty nice spot. Mm-hmm. It was right next to a lake. It was pretty cold. So, you know, experiencing the lake and anything other than a walk around it wasn't going to happen. It was rainy, cloudy.
Mountainy,
yeah. Took a couple of little drives and walks, but that's about it. We stayed quarantined, and after that was done, we headed into Vancouver for a little bit.
We celebrated Allo's birthday by going to Stanley Park.
Yeah, more big trees. And it was a little bit of beach area. People were out. We saw palm trees. I didn't know those were in British Columbia, but sure enough.
We also saw the gates to Vancouver's Chinatown.
Yes, and that's also a very prominent Chinatown that most people don't know about. It's quite big, quite nice. Oddly enough, there's the town from Rambo, where the first blood was shot, was like right down the road from where we were staying. I only realized this after going there to pick something up, and there's all these signs for pictures to be taken in the town and with a Rambo figurine. So it was kind of Rambo cutout, I should say. So it was kind of funny. The big thing for us during this time was deciding what to do next. Originally, what we wanted to do is drive north with the trailer into Alaska, Yukon, even touch Northwest Territories. And after that, our trip would be complete. But now we were thinking about how it might have been better to drop the trailer off somewhere like in Kamloops, which is just a little north, and we'd meet Kamloops on the way back home, and then we'd just stay in hotels, because it'd be about the same when we thought about figuring gas and all that kind of stuff and comfort. So now everything is completely different. We just learned that Denali National Park has closed its doors, and a few others in Alaska. So what's really the point of going
and
up there?
Beyond that, they had just closed the borders while we were quarantining in BC. So we wouldn't be able to get to Alaska anyway.
Yeah. So even going up to Yukon, I guess, was quite a drive just to enter Yukon. We knew that this is pretty much going to have to wait till another time in our lives, and that effectively this trip was over. This journey, this adventure was closing its doors, and we had to make it home. The crazy part is that we didn't want to be driving back yet because of the weather. It's quite treacherous crossing the Rockies right now, especially with a trailer. But now we had to find the perfect window to kind of head back west and have the bad weather not follow us. So we packed everything up 2 or 3 days early before our camping time expired, because we thought that this is the best time for us to make it over the Rockies. After this, for like a week or two, it was going to be crazy weather and we just would not be able to cross. And so we did that. We knew that we wouldn't be able to pick up any water. We knew that we wouldn't be able to do much cooking because we can't clean dishes. Everything was going to change after this because of how cold it would be at night. And that every service area that does this is not open yet for the season, right? This was still...
And if it was open, if things were attached to gas stations, there was no guarantee that these gas stations would be open for us anyway.
Yeah. So there was a lot of uncertainties. We just knew that the best thing is to just eat out for this week heading home and try not to get too dirty and just rough it till we get home.
So we decided to get home as fast as possible. The original plan was also to spend a couple more weeks in Banff, camp, do some hiking in the spring, enjoy that place one more time because we all really, really loved Banff a lot. But all of that changed. So we had, because of the weather, and we didn't want to get stuck anywhere crazy in any amount of snow, we decided just to boot it home as quickly as possible.
And you know what? Since everything was closed anyway, that's how it turned out. We tried to make it to Banff in one day. We left in the morning. By the time we arrived in Banff, by the time we were crossing that part of the Rockies, night had fallen, snow was on the ground, snow was in the air. It was slushy. It was a white knuckling experience, going very slow. We were going like 40, 50 kilometers an hour, crossing some areas. It was just so hairy. But we arrived, we stayed at, there's no campsites open in Banff, so we just stayed in this little visitors area.
Yeah, what's unique about Banff is that they don't allow overnight parking anywhere because it's Banff. So if you want to sleep there, you have to have a campsite or a hotel or something like that. And so because every single campsite was closed in Banff, we couldn't do that. And so we found this recreation center and we saw a couple other campers there. So we're like, well, we'll take our chances because you can get heavily fined in Banff for sleeping in your RV on a random street. So we took our chances and around 9 o'clock on Sunday morning, a park ranger comes and he's like, well, you're really not supposed to be here, after they had already let us spend the whole night there.
But they know. They're just doing their job, but they know that we had really no option.
They gave us that grace.
Yeah, we had no option. Yeah, we had no option. Right? Another kind of cool thing, though, entering Canada was we noticed the gas prices had dropped dramatically. Of course, this was due to COVID and that market tanking and no pun intended. And it was going to make it kind of it was a bit of a pleasant surprise because now we're going to cross the country at a reduced rate for gas consumption, right?
Yeah.
Or costs. So we're trying to look on the bright side. Let's just say this. We would have preferred to have higher gas prices and had the experiences we wanted, but take what you can get.
We couldn't go through any drive-thrus with our trailer and they weren't letting anybody actually inside any restaurants. And so we had to order a curbside pickup or something like that. And so a lot of places actually, you know, when we were able to tell them about our predicament, were actually very, very kind to us and would take our order through a window or something like that. People were very accommodating.
So we made it into our home province of Ontario. And this is quite a big province to cross. It's like bigger than Texas. I guess we were coming in from the north. We passed a town called White River and we see this Winnie the Pooh statue and like, what is this? So we decided to stop and walk over to it. And this is apparently where Winnie the Pooh was from, the bear the whole story's inspired.
Lieutenant Harry Colburn purchased the bear here in White River.
For $20.
He named it Winnie for $20. 1914, went to the London Zoo, and then the legend began. Walt Disney Company.
So from there we left and we were heading to our hometown. Of course, we didn't have a home there. We didn't have too much in terms of what plans we'd be pursuing next. There's some opportunities for us nearby where we wanted to get a property and build something on it. And we stopped by there and found out that it's not going to work out. So a lot of those comforting things that you look forward to when you arrive back after a long trip were not afforded us. But luckily we had great friends who had a property and a home that they were not using, that they were going to be tearing down one day and rebuilding a new one for their place where they would retire. They weren't using this place and they're like, they offered it to us to park and live in until we get our feet on the ground and get things sorted.
Hey, what do you guys think of your last night in the trailer? Possibly, huh?
I don't know.
So this is where we have been. By their generosity, we've had this place to unpack and settle in.
And
While we were here, we sold the trailer, which had been our home for 4 years. And that was sad. That was sad to go see it go. I cleaned her all up and she found a new home. And of course, we used the truck for a little bit, but there was really no use for that kind of a heavy-duty truck unless you're towing something. So we got a little tiny Honda Fit, and that became our main car. And then slowly, the decision was made to sell our truck, Charlie. And he's in a new home too now.
Last ride in Charlie. Say bye, guys. Bye to Charlie. Pet him. Look at all that leg room. Oh no. Bye, Charlie. You've been a good car.
We don't know exactly what the future holds for us or when we'll get to really finish off our trip by going to Alaska and doing the Yukon and Northwest Territories. But we're pretty sure it's not going to be in a trailer. We're probably going to fly and rent a car and finish up the 50th state by then in that way. I do want to say though that despite all of these kilometers we put on, all these years on the road, we've had no issues aside from that pop tire that came from my neglect. You know, I could see the belt and I let it run. We had no breakdowns. We were graciously spared so much. Certainly a huge blessing on our lives to be able to have done this trip. And God only knows what dangers we could have encountered along the way in some of the places we stayed, but He protected us through it all and brought us to this place safe and sound. Here's some more fun numbers of the places we've been and how many national parks we got to experience, and just some more fun facts about our 4-year journey.
Okay, so here are some places we stayed. along our travels. We stayed at 53 Walmarts, sometimes up for a week. We stayed at 22 Cracker Barrels, 25 campsites, 9 side roads or Bureau of Land Management areas, BLMs, 8 boondockers, 6 hardware stores, 11 outdoor stores like Cabela's or Bass Pro, 4 Airbnb hosts, 1 Costco, 2 RV dealers, 1 mall, 1 recreation center, 2 casinos, 5 hotels, 5 friends' houses on their property where we stayed in the RV, 5 friends' homes where we parked the RV and stayed inside, and 1 ferry terminal. Staying in these parking lots, we never got broken into, leaving the trailer sometimes all day for several days in a row. Never got evicted in the middle of the night, although warned twice with 1 written warning on the door the next morning. So we've been on the road for 4 years since selling our house and traveling on and off. We traveled approximately 100,000 kilometers or 60,000 miles. And here is a map of the 3 lakes we did over those 4 years. In the past, we explored New England and the eastern states in Canada in some detail. So in 2006, along with retracing our steps, we added new destinations as we headed to the very tip of Canada and then south, spending winter in Florida before going west to Louisiana and then up north on a path home in 2017. Also in 2017-2018, we flew to Hawaii and we island hopped for 6 months among the 4 major islands. In 2019, we did the majority of our drivings heading west, starting in the States and again across some familiar ground in Canada until we reached the Rockies, but into new territory as we headed into the middle of America, also hugging the mountain ranges and ultimately spending Christmas in Texas. Then heading up the western coast and a new range of mountains before heading back home across Canada. We visited 49 states, including Hawaii, only Alaska is missing, and we did all 10 Canadian provinces, no territories. We experienced 42 US national parks and 11 Canadian national parks to various degrees, plus dozens of state and historic parks, where the kids did a ton of junior ranger programs. While traveling, we had 0 breakdowns, 1 blown tire on the trailer, 3 sets of tires on the truck, and 2 sets of tires on the trailer had to be replaced. We had 0 accidents or animals hit, although we came close in both cases. Hey. 1 speeding ticket in Saskatchewan, 11 kilometers or 6 miles over the speed limit. We traveled on 3 ferries with the trailer and hunkered down for 4 incoming tornadoes, one that missed us by less than half a mile. So that is our trip in numbers.
Well, thanks for watching, and hopefully we can make another chapter down the road about Alaska and those northern territories. Bye for now.